words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts. Be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer.
Amen.
Welcome to Lent. This is the first Sunday in Lent. And in preparation for the sermon, I was struck by the lesson that was chosen to be the kind of doorway into Lent for us. It's the story of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. And I think of Lent as to look at my temptations. But the doorway is first to look at Jesus' temptation. And in that sense, I think it's kind of preparation, an invitation, I thought, to meditation, to a kind of meditation about ourselves in Lent. Meditation about our role in life under God. So my sermon this morning is kind of a sermon, but it's also kind of a meditation. You can call it a sermon slash meditation. It's a little of each. I offer it to you as a way to begin your meditation and thoughtfulness about your walk with Christ during this Lenten season. First, let's look at Christ's temptation. To understand anything in the New Testament, as I always say, you have to see it in context of the world Jesus was living in those days. It was a world of severe oppression, occupation by a foreign country, occupation by Rome, in collaboration with the Jewish leaders who were benefiting by serving under them. Hopefully serving the people, but not too well. Jesus has been following John the Baptist, who, along with many others, are looking for the Messiah, the coming of the Messiah that will lead them out of that kind of oppression. People are gathered at the Jordan, and John is preaching, and then he baptizes the folks there, and Jesus is baptized. And then, shortly after he is baptized, the Holy Spirit descends upon Jesus, seizes him, fills him, and it descends, as Luke says, in the form of a dove. Immediately after that, the Spirit leads Jesus where? Out into the wilderness. Out into the wilderness. If you look, that's the story in all three of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. If you look at the Gospel of Mark, Jesus doesn't lead, the Spirit doesn't lead Jesus out of the wilderness, it drives him out of the wilderness. It's out of the wilderness that Jesus has to be for 40 days in meditation to figure out what he's going to do with the Spirit and his filled. Where is he going to put all that energy? What's going to happen as a servant of God? And that's what he struggles with in the wilderness. Several years ago, I came across a fascinating book entitled The Solace of Fierce Landscapes. The Solace of Fierce Landscapes. And part of the thesis of the book is that the major religions of the world were born in fierce landscapes. If you think of that with Jesus in the wilderness in temptation, you can see how he is being shaped for his mission, being shaped by being given three major temptations and his response to it, and finally deciding how he's going to carry out his mission. So let's look first at the temptation. First, the temptation, he's been there for 40 days, and so he's famished. And the devil comes and tempts him to turn a stone into bread. I interpret that to mean to use his energy, and somehow kind of use magic, to meet his practical needs. To have something to eat and put into his mouth. And Jesus responds by saying, man cannot live by bread alone. Man cannot live by bread alone. The second temptation, as you recall, was a temptation really for political power. It's interesting that in the text this morning, all this kind of thing has been given to the devil. And when I look at our political leaders, I wonder if there's more truth in that than I usually think about. But he's invited to have this power, to rule all the nations and to bask in the glory of that. And Jesus' response to that is, we shall serve the Lord our God and only him. And then finally, the devil takes Jesus and leads him immediately into the temple in Jerusalem and says, throw yourself down from him, from here, and God will take care of you. He will send his angels to catch you so you won't even bruise your feet. And I hear that as a temptation to be exempt from the laws of physics, the laws of being alive, in this world, to be more than a human being. We think of the incarnation means taking on human flesh, but temptation is to somehow be exempt from. And his response is that he cannot do that. And he does not. You shall not tempt the Lord your God. Those are Jesus' temptations. When you subtract all those things out, what he has left to do as the Messiah is to follow the way of love, which does not use religion for personal gain. There are good benefits in the religious life, lots of benefits. Just physiologically, there's been research shown that people who come to church regularly are involved in their church and prayer and meditation. Physically, you're going to be healthier. When you go to a hospital, statistics are you're going to get out a little sooner. If you're taking meds, you may get off of them sooner. Good things happen. But that's not what happens. It's important, but we cannot live by that alone. I look at our society, which works hard, I think, to live by bread alone. We are a consumer in a consumer culture. If we buy this car, then we will arrive. And it's wonderful for 3 or 4 days. And then we see another car that looks a little nicer. Go to a barbershop. This is wonderful. Well, really look good. Right? 3 or 4 days. It's kind of like drugs. You get on one, and it feels good. And you just bump with it. But always be money. So, literally, we cannot live by bread alone. Our hunger, as Augustine said, we hunger and thirst until we find God. We cannot live by bread alone. But that's one of our temptations. The second temptation is for power. Now, few of us have a political position to have power and to abuse it, but we all have power in our jobs, people under us, people who work for us, servants that we may hire. When I go to a store, I'm shopping for something. I really have power over the person waiting on me. I can abuse it or I can be nice about it, whether I want to buy the product. I've got power. In my family, I've got power. Am I going to be dominant, use a domination kind of thing, or some other way? That's my temptation, and yours too. And I invite, as I say all these things, to think about yourself, how you are tempted by the same temptation you fought. To use bread, to use power, and even the temptation to go to the temple and just you know, throw itself off. That's the temptation to feel, because of your religion, that you're exempt from the laws of physics, the laws of biochemistry that keeps you alive. We're not exempt. And that's what Jesus was aware of. He does not claim that exemption, nor do we. It's for us, like Jesus, to decide how we are going to use the energy we get from our life as Christians. Think of your own baptism. If you're like me, you won't be able to remember it. I was born in Washington, D.C., baptized somewhere, as I say, I wanted to be close to my mother. Think of your baptism. Think as best you can if you were baptized as an adult, you can. Think also, though, of those times when the Spirit has filled you. Those moments of ecstasy, of wonder, and awe, and where you encounter. I'm addicted to wild places and the height of the wild places, and I find the Spirit there. I find the Spirit in poetry and in art. I find the Spirit there. And I find the Spirit in community, such as this community here in Santa Fe. But think for a moment about where you find God's presence and a kind of living the new way, even for a few minutes. The decision that you and I always have to make, maybe going alone in long silence and tempting ourselves, is how are we going to use that in our life? How are we going to use it? So as a part of the meditation for Lent, you might think of all these three things and how they affect you and how you want to live out your life as a Christian, as a Lenten practice. I think of a poet, 17th century poet named Robert Herrick, had a wonderful poem about to keep a true Lent. And one of the lines in that Lent are these. To starve thy sin, not bitter, and that's to keep thy Lent. To starve thy sin, not bitter, and that's to keep thy Lent. When I think of any of us, and myself especially, being filled by the Spirit, and how I'm going to use that in service, I find that a daunting thing. So as I enter Lent, this is daunting if I take this seriously. What am I going to do? And one of the things I remind myself is I am not required to reach perfection, to savor. And neither of us, we're not going to make that. I think it's more like a compass whose needle always points north. And we try to keep ourselves focused on the path, the direction we want to move in and go in that way. Lest we kind of glamorize the Christian life, I would like to tell you a little bit about someone that, for me, is an outstanding example of how he felt about where he was. Thomas Merton, you know about him, read his books, Roman Catholic priest, Roman Catholic monk, who Trappist, they didn't talk. Trappist at Gethsemane Seminary in Kentucky. He was a hermit. He didn't live with the other monks there. They gave him an old little tiny house. And he lived there by himself. But strange to be a hermit, he was in correspondence, letters, for people all over the country, and was deeply involved in many social issues at that time. Immigration struggle and the war in Vietnam. And many of his letters were to call attention to, in his view, the sinfulness of us, the people, being involved in that. Anyway, interestingly enough, by the way, he led his Roman Catholic, he led his church into interfaith dialogue with Buddhist monks. And he died actually. In Thailand, where he had gone for a conference with Buddhist monks. And there, through an accident, he finished one of his talks that he gave to his assembly, and he went to his room to take a shower, and came out of the shower, and there was an electric fan there that had a short, and he happened to touch the fan, and was electrocuted. But interestingly enough, when his body was flown back to this country, it was put on board an airplane with soldiers from Vietnam that had died. So he came back with the people of the day. Here is Thomas Merton, far, far in advance on the spiritual journey. He himself spent hours and hours and hours in deep meditation in the wilderness. And in those, that wilderness time, in his own life, he would let the dark side of himself come forward. And to accept that, the part of himself that I please accept that. And because of that long practice, he became very real as a human being. And when you were with Thomas Merton, you felt you were with a person who was very real. And when he was looking at you, he was fully present. And you knew you were in a special place. I want to read you a prayer that he wrote, how he experienced himself eternally. And it was not all that glorious. It's kind of that's all. Here's his prayer. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself. The fact that I think I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does, in fact, please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing. Therefore will I trust you always, though I may seem lost in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. I welcome you to the meditation on Jesus' temptation and our own and to the journey. Welcome.
Let us stand and say aloud together the Nicene Creed. Amen. We believe in one God.